Morning, church.
Morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Good to be here with you. Your pastor, Pastor Eric, we have actually several things in common. So, first of all, the first thing in common was that, you know, we pastored together, the Big Alley together, for a while, several years, I think like 7, 8 years. And then, second thing we have in common is that when we first started pastoring, both of us were actually single. And so, you know, I've been married for like 13 years. And so when I first started pastoring Big Alley, you know, we were single and everything. But you know, the members nowadays, the members, they always try to, you know, find and kind of do matchmaking. Have you ever done that here? Apparently they do so good of a job here, okay, in Waipahu, because he's still single, right? And so I remember forget that, you know, one thing the Big Island always had was, we always had a special, like, bond of the pastors on the Big Island. So on the Big Island, we always got together, and we actually spent time, we always get together, pastor, we got together, we planned together, we actually prayed together, and Pastor Eric, you know, he said, like, we haven't seen that in other places, and so it actually was a real blessing being there. But I'll never forget one time we got together, and here we are in this Kohala church, and we met at different churches, so we had Kohala that weekend at the church I was pastoring at. And we're talking about, you know, I just got married, I have my child, and we're talking about, you know, Eric and why he's not married yet, right? So we started talking a little about that, and then, out of nowhere, he has a nice presentation, right? Presentation of how to find a good spouse. And a lot of qualities of a good spouse. They were like, wow, you know, he's really thought this thing through. But we need to pray for him. What do you say, amen?
Amen.
But I know that God has the right person for him. Not us trying to matchmake. Because you know, I told my church members, I said to them, look, if you try and find matchmaking with someone, I'm actually going to make a purpose not to marry that person. Uh-huh. So they purposely stayed all away from me in like matchmaking. And then when they actually saw my wife come in, they actually wanted to matchmake us, but then they heard what I said, so they actually purposely didn't try and matchmake us because they didn't want to like ruin the only opportunity, right? So, and then God brought us together. So, and we, you know, that's God being a matchmaker. When you say amen,
amen,
he'll work it out. And I know how it is, the pressure of being a single pastor is very, very hard at times. And so just pray, you know, keep praying for your pastor, support him. I know you support him, and he loved him. So. Yeah, good memory. He really loves this church, I can tell. He's told me he loves this church, so he really loves it. Yeah, I'm blessed to be here with you this Sabbath. So thank you for having us. This morning, I invite you to turn to me in our opening text this morning. There's more to say, but I didn't want to embarrass him too much, yeah? So I just mentioned just a little bit. Okay, so Exodus chapter 33, verse 18 and 19 is the opening text. If you have your Bibles, would you please turn to me there? Exodus chapter 33, verse 18 and 19 is the opening text. And today's message is entitled, Seeing God's Thoughts and Feelings. Seeing God's Thoughts and Feelings. Now, first of all, you may think about this sound very blasphemous, maybe, but as you go through the study, you're going to see that this is very biblical as we study this thought. So seeing God's thoughts. So if you could look into the mind of God, what do you think you would see? Would you see what you think you would see, or would it be a completely different picture than what you think? I like to suggest that God's thoughts, you know, many times we think that maybe God doesn't even have feelings, right? But God's thoughts and feelings is not what we think it is, but instead God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts as the heavens are above the earth. What do you say, amen?
Amen.
Now, what we're going to do is we're going to look at how God's mind works, but because we're created in the image of God, we're also going to learn how our mind works. Because this is going to help us in our battle against Satan, our battle against sin, our battle against addictions, whatever it is. When we understand how we are created and how our mind works, we're going to better have the grasp of victory in our lives. And I want victory. How about you? What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
You know, we had a study last night in the home, and the study wasn't so much. What came on the end, somebody said, you know what it is? It's not so much talking about how good God is. It's not talking about how much God is love. It's not talking about His character of love. The real issue is, are we actually showing that love to other people in a church, in a home, in a community? What do you say, amen? Because our actions is not matching what we're saying, even in the churches. And I want a life that actually is changed and revealing the true character of God's love. How about you? How many want that? Let me see hands this morning. What do you say, amen? So this morning we're going to be looking at that as we open the Word. So Exodus 33, verse 18 and 19. As we open God's Word, may God open His thoughts to us. Let us pray. Father, Lord, may You speak and may Your love shine through. And may we see a clearer picture of Your thoughts. We thank You in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Let's look at God's glory. Look at Exodus 33. What did Moses ask God to do? Look at verse 33, verse 18. And he said, Moses said to God, please show me your what?
Glory.
Glory, right? So Moses asked God to show him his glory. And in verse 19, then he said, God said, I will make all my what?
Goodness
pass before you, and I will proclaim the what?
Name
of the Lord. So God's glory is his, first of all, his what? His name, right? And also his what? According to this text, it's what?
Goodness.
His goodness, right? So God's goodness and His name, okay? And then Moses went in Exodus 34, verse 5 to 7, okay? And then God explained what His name is. Look at 34, verse 5 to 7. The Bible said, now the Lord descended in His cloud and stood with Him there and proclaimed the what?
Name of the Lord.
Name of the Lord. So God says, my glory is my name, and then I'll explain what my name is. And then it says here, and the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and what?
Truth,
keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquities and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. So all these is merciful, right? Kindness, goodness, right? All these things, graciousness, patience. What are these called? These are what?
Character
traits, right? So God's glory is His name, which is His character. Okay, so that's His character, who God is. So these character traits, right, it reveals who God is. And we know that God is, 1 John 4, verse 8, God is what? God is love. So God has a character, or has a name of love. So that's why, you know, this name of God and who is, you know, like inside, I was sharing last night the study, you know, my daughter's name is Kaimilani. And that name means in Hawaiian, seeker of heaven. So it's my desire that my daughter would be a seeker of heaven, right? So like, do you live up to your name? So in the Hawaiian culture, you have the Hawaiian culture where you actually have the child born, and after they're born, after they see how the baby acts or certain character traits in the baby, then they name the baby after they see how the character is like. And so they name it certain names and everything. So the same way, that's how it was in the days of Jesus, you know, in the Oriental culture, you know, they actually are born and then they actually have them circumcised and they have them dedicated to the Lord and they gave him the name, what is his name, and describe the name Jesus, right, remember? It was after they saw the character traits and they not only put a name to follow because of what a person's name is who they will become, right? Like in the Bible says in the first Samuel about Nabal, right? Abigail said, as his name is, what? So is what? He. In other words, Nabal is fool. It means fool. He was very foolish. So Nabal said, please, David, don't kill my husband because as his name is, so is he. He's a fool. That's why he's acting like a fool. He's only living up to his name. And so what God is saying here in this text, what God is saying is, look, my glory is really who I am. And isn't that life eternal, that they may know thee, right? The true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast said. So in other words, when Moses said, God, please show me your glory, God is saying, okay, I'm going to reveal to you who I really am. I want to know who God is. What about you? Amen?
Amen.
I want to see who he really is. Not what people make him out to be, not what the church says he is, not what servants make him out to be, but I want to see God's glory, God's character, especially in these last days. If you look, Proverbs 23, verse 7 in your Bibles. Proverbs 23, verse 7. What determines what a person is? Know what the Bible says. Proverbs 23, verse 7. The Bible says, for as he what? Does in his heart, what does it say? As he what? Thinks in his heart, what? So is what? He. So what a person is based upon how they what? What they
think.
In other words, what you think is what you are. For you are what you think, right? Okay, look at your handout here. there's a handout here in the study. And inside your bulletin, seeing God, thoughts, and feelings, you see that? And look at the first quotation. This is from In Heavenly Places, page 164. I want you to notice what makes up the character, okay? And it says here that the thoughts and the what?
Feelings
what? Combined make up the what?
Character.
Or what? Character, right? So in other words, character made out of one thing or two things?
Two things,
okay? So we're made out of thoughts and feelings, right? Think about that. So my next question is this. What is the only thing we're going to take to heaven? Our works and our actions? Or our thoughts and our feelings?
Character.
Our character, right? But what is character? Our what?
Thoughts and feelings.
So the only thing we're going to take to heaven is our what? Thoughts and our feelings, right? That's clear. Let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
But yet we're judged by our actions that reveal really the inside. The outside reveals the inside what's really our true thoughts and feelings are, right? Anybody need handouts? They're being handed out right now. Thank you. Lawrence. Okay, they're in front. Oh, thank you. So thoughts and feelings combined. Now I want you to notice that thoughts and feelings is internal rather than external. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Now, our actions reveal something else, our thoughts and feelings. And I want you to look at, now, what else, how does it work, the thoughts and the feelings? So we both have in our minds, everyone in here has thoughts plus feelings, okay? But how does the formula work? How does it work? I mean, how does it work together, back and forth, or whatever it is, with the thoughts and feelings? How does it actually work within our lives? So if you look at your next quotation, notice what it says here about thoughts. So thoughts and feelings equals character. But I want to notice what it says in Heavenly Places, page 164. It continues the thought and it says this. If the thoughts are wrong, the what? The feelings will be what?
Wrong.
So in other words, feelings always follow thoughts. Are you following me? Feelings always follow thoughts. So in other words, if you have good thoughts, then you have right thoughts, then you have what? What kind of feelings?
Good feelings.
Right feelings, good feelings. If you have bad thoughts, then you have what kind of feelings?
Bad feelings.
Does that make sense? Bad feelings, right? If that's clear, let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
So in other words, if you want to have good feelings, then we need to have what kind of thoughts?
Good thoughts,
because feelings always follow thoughts, right? But I'm trying to help you understand how your mind works. Because once you understand how your mind works, then you can better have this victory talking about over our addictions, right? Our depression, our anxiety, our stress, a victory over sin. I want that. How about you? Amen?
Amen?
So you know how your mind clicks because we're made in the image of God. So God also has a glory. He has a character, right? He has thoughts and feelings. Can you imagine we think that, oh, God doesn't have feelings? No, God has feelings. What do you say? Amen?
Amen?
Not evil feelings, but he has a sanctified feelings. What do you say? Amen? And God, and you know, as Christians, and there was a time in my Christian walk that was so anti-feelings because, you know, we hear feelings is wrong, we shouldn't follow our feelings. Some of you heard that before, right? Which is true. But we shouldn't follow our negative, evil, wrong feelings. What do you say? Amen? But it's just like there's good thoughts, there is also what? Bad thoughts, right? In the same way, when there's good feelings, there's the sanctified feelings, right? And there's also bad feelings. So I used to be like totally anti-feelings, totally against feelings, everything. But you know what? There is also godly, sanctified feelings. And I want that in my life. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
Because it cannot be like, okay, only negative thoughts we're not going to take to heaven. The Bible says, I mean, Inspiration also says that the thoughts and feelings combined make up the moral character, right? So in other words, we're going to take not only good thoughts to heaven and all feelings behind on this earth. No, we're going to take good thoughts to heaven and we're also going to take good feelings to heaven. That's going to let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
And I know we're very anti-feelings, but the meaning stick to the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. I don't want that. Amen?
Amen.
So, in this, I want you to look at, inside your handouts, it has those diagrams that I kind of wrote out. So, I want you to notice what it says here, the next quotation, and it says this. Confound not faith and feelings together. So okay, people say, well, you know, we need to totally throw away all kind of feelings. But notice what it says. There's a difference between faith and feelings. And I want you to see the difference. They are distinct. Faith is ours to exercise. This faith, you must keep it exercised. Believe, believe. Let your faith take hold of the blessing, and it is yours. Your feelings have nothing to do with this faith. Can you amen? Amen?
Amen.
Okay, this is how it works, faith and feelings. And it says here, when faith brings a blessing to your heart, and you rejoice in that blessing, it is no more faith, but what?
Feelings.
Feelings. Sanctified feelings. So in other words, we don't live by our feelings, because our heart is desperately wicked, right? Mm-hmm. Above all things, right? We can't trust our own hearts, because our feelings are going to... That's why, you know, one of the great temptations, and actually counterfeits of the Word of God, you know, Satan has three main counterfeits of the Word of God and the great controversy. One of them was actually fanaticism, which is actually put feelings above the Word of God. But you know what? The Word of God should always be above our feelings. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
So in other words, when we actually look to the Word of God and faith, believe in the Word of God, and by faith bring those promises of the Word of God down into our hearts, and then no longer that faith, this faith anymore, but then it turns to good sanctified feelings. And I want the good sanctified feelings in my life. How about you? Let me see your hand. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
That's what God wants to experience. So that's how it works. That's the big picture of how faith and thoughts and feelings and God's character works in our life. And think about it. We think about the only thing we'll take to heaven. We focus on externals and all the things we've got to do and external Sabbath keeping and all that. But God is looking on the heart, right?
Amen.
He's looking for the inside, the internal. The sanctified thoughts, the sanctified feelings, the inside. We need a heart reform. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
All God's church, I believe, in these last days, we need a heart reform. A revival first. And the reformation on the outside will fall. I believe that. Let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
Now my next question is, what kind of thoughts are we thinking about? Right? So, turn to Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8 in your Bibles. Philippians 4, verse 8. It says here, Philippians 4, verse 8, the Bible says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are what? True. Whatsoever things are what? Honest, right? Whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, what does it say?
Think
on anything. In other words, have your, when you're thinking, that's referring to your thoughts. In other words, these are the type of thoughts we need to have in our mind. What is it? Amen? These are good thoughts. These are not Satan's counterfeit bad thoughts. But you mean look upon these thoughts, because you know Paul knew that if you think upon, you have the thoughts of these good things, these good thoughts in your mind, then you will have, naturally, your feelings will be good, because your feelings always follow your thoughts. And that's why, if we are always thinking upon the negative things in life, right, we will always have negative feelings. Is that not true? That's why it's not good for us to always be watching the negative things that we see on television. Even if it's true. Is that not true? That's why not good to look upon even the negative things in the newspaper. You know, do we really need to look at all the details, the explicit details of how that man was murdered and how gruesome details and all the explicit details of how that woman was raped? And do we really need to read that in the newspaper? Do we really need to watch the news for hours and hours upon all the negative things and the negative thoughts that we put into our mind? And the more we think about these negative thoughts, how do you think you feel after a while when you get these negative thoughts over and over in your mind? What happens to you, think? It affects you. And these negative thoughts, it produces something to you. Not only that, but even the negative things, look at this, here. I don't want to talk about a story. She had a dream, look at this quotation, Sets of Christ. And then she dreamed that she was in a garden, right? And as she was going, sorry, I got cut off. But as she was going to this garden, she saw the thorns. And then the angel said to her, but don't look upon the thorns, look upon the flowers, right? Don't look upon the negative things, look upon the positive things. And even in the church, we can get caught up in the gossip, the rumors, the negative things that's going on about other people. Our workplace can become such negative environments where we actually just focus on the negative. And don't you think that these negative thoughts will affect you or won't affect you? It will. And then we think these negative thoughts and the negative feelings, then we feel junk, right? We feel miserable, we feel grumpy, we're moody, we become irritated with our spouse. become impatient and angry against our children. We fight in the homes, right? Why? Because we're putting these negative thoughts, and then we feel miserable, we feel junk, we feel like irritated, right? And we don't want to treat each other good, and we treat each other really bad. Why? Because our feelings is only following the thoughts that we're putting in within our mind. That's why God wants us to say, think on these things. Don't think upon all these negative things. Now we talked about the inside. But how does our actions deal with the inside? Right? That's a good question. So turn to me to Matthew chapter 12, verse 34 in your Bibles. Matthew chapter 12, verse 34 in your Bibles. What is the relationship between actions and the heart? Look at the Bible says, Matthew chapter 12, verse 34. Look what the Bible says. The Bible says, Jesus said to the Pharisees, "You brood of vipers, how can you be evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the what? The heart." Where's the heart? On the inside or the outside?
Inside.
How can your heart on the inside, right? Out of the abundance of the heart on the inside, the what?
The mouth.
What speaks? The mouth speaking is on the what? Outside. In other words, what happens on the outside only reveals what's already on the what?
Inside,
right? So in other words, actions follows the inside, right? So this is how it works. You look at your handout. So if you have good thoughts, it produces what? You tell me. Produces what? Good feelings, right? And you have good feelings, it produces what?
Good works.
Good works, good action. That's clear. Let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
But if he has bad thoughts, negative feelings, right? Negative thoughts, I mean negative, negative thoughts, right? Bad thoughts. Then you have what? What's next? I kind of get worried. But what is it? You have bad feelings, negative feelings, right? And you have these bad feelings, negative feelings, evil feelings, right? And what happens? You have what? Bad works of bad actions. That's going to let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
So that's, according to the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy, how you work. How I work. And I want to have good thoughts. How about you? What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
You know, how many of you have been seeing all the shootings in Hilo going on this past year? And I guess the murders that's been happening. I mean, kind of seen in the news, I guess. Seen all the bad news. And you can raise your hand, okay? It's okay to see what's going on out there. But then I was, you know, I thought about that, but you know when I was growing up, I was born and raised in Hilo, but when I was a kid, you rarely hear about a murder. Very rarely you hear about it. In fact, I kind of always remember, like I thought it was the first murder they had in Hilo. And what it was is kids were drinking at the old airport one time, and as they were there drinking, there was some kids came out, and they came up behind them, having kneel down executioner style, and then put the gun behind the back of their head, and they shot them and killed these young kids. And that was the first murder, I thought. And you know what? Interesting. When I first started interning, I interned pastor in Maui under Pastor Bob Cowan. I mean, you guys know, anyone knows him. But there I was in Maui, and I had the opportunity of going to the prison to do a visitation. And of all people who got to visit, was a guy who pulled the trigger, who actually did a double murder executioner style.
Oh.
And you know what the interesting thing is? And this is not only his experience, but apparently he had been raised somehow in Adventism a long time ago.
Wow.
So you are visiting him, talking to him, and you know what they were going around town in Hilo, driving around, and you tell me, what kind of music do you think they were listening to before they jump out of that car, put the gun behind their head, and pull the trigger against the two guys that killed the guy? Well, you tell me, what kind of music, you take a wild guess, you tell me what kind of music you're listening to. What kind of thoughts through the words of the music were they putting in their brain that they go out and pull the trigger? You tell me.
Metallica.
Yeah, gangster rap music. I'm going to shoot the pull the trigger and kill you, right? That's the kind of music. So, you tell me, is it not true that the type of music we listen to can affect the thoughts that we put in our minds, can actually affect how we feel, and how we feel can actually affect the actions in our lives? Is that not true?
Yes.
That's why God has said, think on these things, not on these evil things that's going on. Now God wants us, everything in our lives, God wants us to be pure. Not to look at the negative things on TV, not to look at the bad things in the words, in the music that we listen to. Not in the books we read or whatever it is. God wants our minds, especially as we enter these last days. I believe we live in the last days. What about you? What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
And this is a time that God's people need to have pure minds, pure feelings, and pure words. Now, here's the problem. What kind of thoughts do we now normally have? Turn to me to Mark chapter 7 in your Bibles. Mark chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. Mark chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. What kind of thoughts do we normally have? The Bible says, Mark 7, verse 21 to 23. The Bible says, 21, for from without, is that what it says? It says, from within, out of the heart of men, what's the heart, on the outside or the inside? Inside proceed what? Evil what? Thoughts. Adulteries, fornication, murder, theft, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. In other words, out of the man's corrupt heart comes evil one.
From within comes
evil one. Thoughts. In other words, all of us, because we have a wicked heart, naturally have evil thoughts. So in other words, we don't have to wait to hear that music with evil words in it, right? Bad words in it, to actually begin to have evil thoughts. Are you following me, right? Off our own evil hearts, because the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, from within spring out evil thoughts. So in other words, we can go out to a mountain, go buy land on a big island, 5 acres out in Hamakua Coast, which is what I did, right? I'm here. And I went 5 acres in Hamakua Coast, away from everyone else. I lived off the grid for 10 years. Away from all the evils of the world, right? Protect my family from the evils of the world. When the evil was still inside of my own heart. Are you following me? So you can externally run from all the evils of this world, and yet still in your heart be in the world. Is that not true? Because the heart is off the world. So the evil thoughts produces evil feelings and evil works, but you don't have to look too far, that it's actually within our own hearts. Now, that's why you and I especially, I need a new heart this morning. We need a heart transplant. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
We need an old heart of stone to be taken out, a new heart of flesh to be put within, and only Jesus can do that.
Amen.
And that's what the gospel is. We're not just a moral religion that we can look upon, you know, read good things all the time and listen to good things and all these good things, think that it's going to just change our heart. No, God needs to come into our lives and He needs to give us a new heart. We need to actually repent and turn from self to Christ. And what happens when how does this happen? Turn to Romans chapter 2 verse 4. It's one of my favorite texts, Romans 2 verse 4. What happens when we see God's goodness? What the Bible says here. Bible says, do you despise the riches of His goodness? Don't despise God's goodness, His forbearance and long-suffering patience. Not knowing, don't you know that the goodness of God leads you to what?
Repentance.
Repentance. In other words, when we see God's goodness, which is His character, right? We talked about earlier, right? God's goodness is His glory, His name, His character, His thoughts and feelings. When we see God's thoughts and feelings, which is His character, right? God's thoughts and feelings of love toward us, it changes our hearts. Can you have repentance without seeing God's goodness? Is that a good question? Can you have repentance without seeing God's goodness, according to this text? You cannot. I mean, can you read your Bible and not see God's goodness and still get repentance? Can you get repentance without seeing God's goodness, even though you read your Bible? Is that possible? Do you think there could be people out there reading the Bible, and yet they haven't experienced God's repentance? Do you think that happens? Yeah? Why? Because they're searching the Scriptures, right? Thinking they have eternal life. But these are they which testify of God's goodness. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says the whole world is full of the goodness of God. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
Let us research, allow God to reveal His goodness to us. And it's only when we see His goodness that we actually can experience change. So this is how it works. We have good thoughts, right? It produces what? Good what? Good feelings, right? And it produces what over here? Good what?
Good works.
Good works. But in order to get these good thoughts over here, can we change our own heart and get our own thoughts on our own, good thoughts on our own?
No.
What we need to do? We need to see what? God's good thought, because by beholding God's good thoughts, we become what?
Change.
What do you say? Amen?
Yeah.
We need to see God's goodness, His character, His thoughts and feelings of love, and behold His thoughts and feelings of love, our thoughts and feelings become changed, right? Our thoughts change, our feelings are then changed, and then we have our good works. And many times we become like, almost like, you know, we become like moral police on the outside, external beings. It's like the police. The police cannot solve the problem. They're just going out and taking people who are doing wrong action and throwing them into jail. It's almost like we become moral police and we're just stuck on the actions over here. Are you following me? On the external, we say, hey, look, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, and don't do that. And by the way, do this and do that. And yet we're not giving them the power and the tools all the way back there. Like, hey, wait a minute, the actions are really just following your what? Your bad feelings, right? And your feelings is really following your what? Your thoughts, right? And your own thoughts, how do you get these thoughts? Well, you need to go to God because you don't have the power within yourself to change your own thoughts. And that's clear. Let me say amen. Amen?
Amen.
And we need to go back on the inside because the outside always follows the inside. What do you say? Amen?
Yes.
God wants us to learn how to do that. The reason why many of us have bad tempers, get irritated with our spouses, we hurt our children, is because we have allowed ourselves to see negative things. We're not looking for the good things of God as found in His Word. I want to see God and His goodness. And I know you want to too. How many has been to the Big Island? Let me see hands up there.
Okay, well,
yeah.
Most of you, okay?
How many have been to the Waikoloa coast with all the hotels, the nice hotels over there? Okay. How many has been to the Kona Village? You ever heard of, let me see hands out there. Wow, yeah, a few of you. I see about a good 10 of you guys. Wow, that's pretty good. So, do you know that tsunami kind of wiped it out the last time, right? The one we had, that earthquake and brought the tsunami. So at this hotel, I actually was asked to do a wedding at this hotel. So I came down, and it was nice on the beach and everything. And I had some time talking to the couple. And they were telling me about this resort. This is probably, on the whole resort, this is probably the top two, one of the top two hotels. It's the most expensive hotel in Waikoloa Coast. And Waikoloa Coast has all these nice resorts everywhere, right? And so there was talking to them, and they said, you know, this resort is so special. They cater to you. Not only they cater to every need that you have, but also it's so simple. I said, what do you mean? He said, you need to take a peek inside of our cabin. So I went to this like bungalow. Yeah, they call it bungalow. It's a bungalow. You go inside, you look inside, and it said, there is no TV inside of this cabin. Bungalow. There is no radio. There is no CD player. There is no internet. There's not even a telephone inside of this room. Nothing. There is one telephone in the whole resort in the lobby. I think these guys pay top dollar for this. Hey, I put up a tent in front of my yard, and I tell you half the price. And here we are as Adventists. We want the latest iPhone and, you know, and all the latest technology. And the richest people in the world will pay the toppest dollar to get get away from what we want. And then I got a phone call. So I'm out done with the wedding, and I'm walking, I'm on the beach, walking and talking. And finally I put my phone away, and I saw, right before I put my phone away, I saw the manager coming toward me. And she said, she wanted to talk to me. I said, okay, we'll see you later. And I hung up and said, you know, Pastor, I just want to tell you I'm so sorry, but I have to let you know that we don't allow anyone or no guests can actually use a cell phone outside of their rooms. Because, you know, guests pay the highest top dollar to come to the resort to get away from all that business stuff they're running away from. And we didn't want no one doing that. So I'm sorry, you can't use a cell phone atop the property. And then I talked to the guests. So they want to produce good thoughts, right? Good feelings. They feel good. They have the best vacation of their life, right? Are you following me? The rest of the world understand these things better than us. So then I have to say, I'm going to talk to these employees. I want to see how they feel. So I interview them. And I used to work in the hotels before. I worked at the Hilton, Waikoloa. You know, I was like to be a valet. I used to be a doorman, recreation, pool recreation. You know, I used to do all those things. I used to work at the camp hire with the little kids, you know. So I said, you know, the employees are the ones you got to talk to because, you know, you can look nice on the outside, but you got to know what they're like, how they're really going on with the employees. So, hey, I talked to them. I said, hey, what do you think about this place? So, is it a good place to work? Or what do you think? And they go, oh, yeah, it's a really good place. I said, really? He said, yeah, you know, there's actually a waiting line of people who want to get into this hotel to work here. And then you know that's a good place. Because the environment is so positive. And don't we need to have our places, our homes, our churches, I talked about last week, have a safe place for our people? What do you say, amen? Environment that is so positive, that's uplifting, that's encouraging, that's not depressing and discouraging and hopeless, right? Some place that's positive. And look, the world is doing this type of thing. They understand how the mind works. And we have been given the word of God and the spirit of prophecy. And beloved, our churches should become places of refuge like this. What do you say, amen?
Amen.
We shouldn't be seeing the rocks crying out there and all the things that we're doing, whether it's the health message, whether it's our resort areas and how our places should be like. Beloved, God has given us as a people to be the heads and not the tails. What do you say, amen? He's called us to be different. He called our lives. Our homes should not be broken. Our children should not be leaving the church and not coming back to church. The most requested prayers to the pastor should not be, Pastor, please pray for my children because they no longer go to church. Are you following me, beloved? It's not just the action. It's not just, you know, talking all these good things in church and hearing a good sermon. It's talking about stuff that's going to change our lives, that we're going to be different people. The gospel needs to work in our lives. It cannot be just kind of talking, well, God is love, God is good, God is all these things. No, the actions need to follow our thoughts and feelings. Beloved, I want that in my life. How about you? Amen?
Amen.
We need a change in our life. You know, we serve a wonderful God. What do you say? Amen? So, God's character is His thoughts and feelings. Moses says, show me your thoughts, God, what it's like. Because if I see your thoughts, my thoughts are going to change for good. Then my feelings are going to change, and then my actions are going to change. So, let's turn to Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. Let's focus a little bit on God's thoughts for us. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. How many know of this text? Let me see your hand. Okay. How many of this is your favorite text? Let me see your hand. Okay, some people have a favorite text. Okay, 29, verse 11. Notice what it says here. The Bible says, for I know... This is God speaking. For I know the what? What's that word? Thoughts. There's that word again, right? Thoughts. Thoughts that I think toward you, says the what? The Lord. Thoughts of what?
Peace.
Peace and not of what?
Evil.
To give you a future and a hope. In other words, the thoughts, we're talking about God's thoughts, seeing, beholding in thoughts will become change. The thoughts that God has for you is only thoughts of peace and goodness, right? And not of evil. What a wonderful God we serve. Amen? Peace, not of evil. God thinks thoughts of peace toward us, not thoughts of evil. God doesn't have any thoughts of evil toward us. What a wonderful God. He has only thoughts and feelings of hope. And beloved, do you need hope this morning? Maybe going through struggles and trials in your own life, but God truly believes in you and has faith in you this morning. What a wonderful God. Amen?
Yeah.
Not only that, but what else does God have? What other thoughts does God have? How abundant is God? Thoughts of love toward us. Turn to Psalms 40, verse 5 in your Bible. Psalms 40, verse 5. This is a couple of texts here to show you about God's thoughts. Psalms 40, verse 5. The Bible says, many, not some, but many, O Lord my God, are your wonderful what? Works which you have done. And then it says, and your what? Thoughts. Many are your works and your thoughts toward us. In other words, your thoughts toward us is always, it's constant, it's always going on. It cannot be recounted to you in order. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be what?
Number.
God's thoughts and love toward us is so much that it could never be estimated. In fact, even if God were to declare audibly all of His thoughts and love toward us, you still couldn't number them. What a wonderful God. Amen?
Amen.
Look, God thinks about you all the time. Psalms 139, verse 17, 18. We're talking about God's character of love. Psalms 139, verse 17, 18. How Also, God thought the love toward us described. The Bible says in verse 17 and 18, the Bible says, how precious also are your what? Thoughts. Is that word again. Thoughts to me. God's character. Oh God, because by beholding His thoughts we become changed. Oh God, how great is the sum of them. If I should count them, there would be more in number than the what?
Sand.
You ever been to the beach? Went to check out Sandy's weeks ago. I like Hapuna Beach on the Big Island. You pick up like a handful of sand and kind of let it run through your fingers. Let me grab a handful of sand. How much grains of sand do you think is in your hand when you grab that? 100, Sam? Listen, but the Bible says God thoughts is more than the sand. You know, God thinks about us all the time. He can't get us out of His mind. What a wonderful God. Amen?
Amen.
Then it says this, when I am awake, I am still with you. In other words, when you're sleeping, when you're awake, God thinks about you. When you're sleeping, God still thinks about you. What do you say? Amen? And then when you weren't even thinking about God, when you're sleeping, God was still thinking about you. Amen? And then when you wake up in the morning, and you were thinking about God, He's still thinking about you. What a wonderful God we serve. Amen?
Amen.
He's always thinking present thoughts. God just can't get you out of His mind. That's how much He loves you. And then there's Luke 2, verse 34 and 35. This is read in the scripture reading this morning. Luke chapter 2, verse 34 and 35. What was revealed when Mary's soul was pierced at the cross? Let me say it. Luke chapter 2, verse 34 and 35. Notice what it says. It says, then Simeon blessed them, said to Mary's mother, behold, this child, so they're in the temple, Mary's there with the baby. Simeon the prophet came and said, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of men in Israel, for the sign which will be spoken against. And then he made this prophecy. He said, yes, he's saying to Mary, Mary, a sword's going to pierce through your own soul also. In other words, when he dies on the cross, your son dies on the cross, your soul, your heart's going to be pierced with pain when you see your son dying on the cross. And the cross, being when your heart was pierced with this pain, what's going to happen? That the what?
Many hearts.
The thoughts of what? Many hearts will be what?
Revealed.
In other words, on the cross, what's going to be revealed? The what? The thoughts of what? One heart or what?
Many
hearts were revealed. So I guess the next question is this. Whose thoughts were revealed at the cross? And I guess the first thing I would like to say is humanity thoughts. Our thoughts that we will be capable of killing our own creator. That humanity is capable of killing God. So the cross revealed that our hearts is desperately wicked and needs a new heart. That's what the cross revealed. And then the second thing, or another heart that was revealed, or revealed the thoughts, was Satan. Is that not true?
Yes.
So on the cross, Satan was saying, hey, look, I'm the good guy, and God is the bad guy, and you know, I'm a good person, God is bad and wicked. But on the cross, through the actions, right, the actions really revealed the thoughts and the feelings on the inside. So the action of Satan murdering God on the cross really revealed the thoughts and the feelings of Satan, what he really wanted to do from the beginning, right? But not only were our thoughts revealed on the cross, and not only Satan's thoughts were revealed on the cross, but more importantly, God's thoughts were revealed on the cross. God's thoughts on the cross, it was revealed at the cross that the thoughts of God's heart was revealed that God's heart was only full of thoughts of love towards you and me. It was at the cross that His real thoughts and feelings toward us was finally revealed at the cross, revealed through His action, God's action, for actions speaks louder than words. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
So the actions of dying on the cross revealed that this was really God's heart all along. It's not that God had to muster His love for us to die on the cross. No. The cross revealed from eternity, ages from past, how much God already loved you and me. What a God. Amen?
Amen.
And so the thoughts of God and what He loves you was revealed. We are to look upon and study the love of God at the cross of Calvary. For at the cross of Calvary, we can clearly see the thoughts and feelings of God more clearly than any other way. By looking upon these thoughts and feelings of love, we then get these same thoughts and feelings in our own minds. That's why we're told to right, spend a thoughtful hour every day, right? Meditating upon the life of Christ, especially the closing scenes. So let's focus upon the cross, on God's thoughts of love toward us. And behold that love, our minds become changed to have good thoughts. So we can have good feelings. And thus we can have good actions and good works. I want that. How about you? What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
So here's my appeal. I'm going to challenge you to have a fast. How many of you ever fasted before? Let me see your hand up there. Okay, great. But this is going to be a different fast. We're going to call it a negativity fast. How's that sound?
Nice.
So for 10 days, this is a challenge. 10 days. Like Daniel. 10-day fast, but a negativity fast. That you're going to fast from everything that is negative. Can I hear a big amen? Amen?
Amen.
And you know the thing? You may think it's easier than you think it is, right? But you know what? I did a sermon in Portland, Oregon. And next week I was at another place and a couple saw me there again. And they said to me, you know, Pastor, we said, great, we're going to do this because, you know, all this fighting and everything. And so we made a pact that we're going to follow this negativity fast. And so we decided to drive to the coast on Sabbath afternoon after your sermon. And so we drive to the coast and said, within 1 hour, we're already at each other's throats, he said. And then I realized, okay, I need to add this into this negativity fast. That is not just us trying to change our hearts and creating good thoughts is actually looking at the originator of good thoughts. What do you say? Amen? Jesus Christ. And so now I present the negativity fast can only work when you spend time with Jesus and look upon His goodness and His good thoughts. What do you say? Amen? Behold the life of Christ. Look upon Jesus, especially at the cross, and reveals a God who loves you. You behold that the good thoughts of God on the cross and how much He loves you, how He has peace for you, how He has hope for you, does something for your heart. It changes you. It changes me. Now I know that we all need God. I need God in my life. How I treat my daughter, you know, when we get into a fight with my wife, you know, I know that, you know, I'm slipping because. And not to force myself to change my actions, I need to go back to the cross. I need to go back to God's love. I need to focus upon His goodness for me. When I see His goodness and His love that He has for me, then I have those good thoughts in my own life. I have those good feelings that I want to do good. And then I have those actions of love that I show to my wife, my daughter, my family, my everyone around me. I want that. How about you? Do you want that? Let me see another. What do you say? Amen?
Amen.
So how many of you willing to do this? That's my appeal. And so my appeal to be in your mind, making in your mind is, at this time, I ask BJ to sing this song. That he knows my name. You know, name represents character, glory, thoughts and feelings. God knows my name. And when we have a name behind His name, and we cover with the righteousness of Christ, then we have His thoughts and His feelings. I want that. How about you? Amen. So think of the words. Make that commitment to God. 10 days negativity fast as He sings this song. He knows my name.
Thank you.
So take your time and think about it. So what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna make that appeal right now. If you felt like, okay, there's something I wanna do, and Lord, I know I can't do it without you, but I want to do this. I'm gonna make an appeal and say, okay, this, I wanna do this negativity fast. I wanna do this for 10 days. I know it's a bold appeal, but if this is what you want, say, okay, Lord, I'll do it for 10 days, I'll make a public stand, I'll invite you. This is what you want? And not anyone, you know, if just one or two person, that's fine. But then when you're in here, Lord, I wanna try this, I wanna do 10 days, I wanna see experience, I wanna do that Daniel challenge, right? 10 days negative fast, this is you. You know, if this is one person here, you want that. You wanna make that 10-day commitment, negativity fast. Anyone here, I invite you, just to stand where we are. If you want to make the commitment, don't worry about anyone else. You don't have to stand, believe me, you don't have to. But if anyone here, praise God. Amen. Just try it out. 10 days. Amen. Praise God. God sees that. I want that. I want that in my better relationships, my marriage, my child, and my loved ones around. Amen. Praise the Lord. Will we all stand for prayer? Father, thank you for that you know our name. You know our where we at. We thank you for Jesus' name, his character, his glory that covers us, and that when you look at us, when we accept Christ, you don't see our sinful characters, but you see the beautiful character of Jesus Christ, the name of Jesus Christ. Because of that, you know our name, you love us, Lord, and we're grateful for that. And so Lord, I pray that as you see this goodness that you made, change our hearts. We do this 10, the people who stood for those 10-day negativity fast, Lord, may they know that there's no power in them to do it. There's no strength in us doing it, but the power is in you. Help us to look upon the love, especially revealed at the cross. May we look and live. We thank you, Lord, for already hearing and already answering our prayer. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.